Our speaker today is Dr. Amritanshu Prasad, Professor of Mathematics at IMSC Chennai. Today he is going to speak on the Frobenius characteristic of a character polynomial. Professor Prasad.
Thank you, Manoj. It's a great pleasure to be speaking at Group Theory Sangam. I'm going to talk about the representation theory of the symmetric groups, and it's going to be a talk mostly about computational techniques. So you won't see big theorems, but you'll see ways to compute things. And so let's start with talking about the symmetric group itself. So the symmetric group, of course, as you know, it's all functions from the set 1 to n to itself, bijective functions. And when you have such a function, you can display it in a certain way, which reveals its structure. So for example, here I've written down a permutation on the right-hand side, 5, 2, 7, 10, 9, 12, 6, 3, 4, 1, 8, 11, 6, which means that 1 goes to 5, 2 goes to 2, 3 goes to 7, 4 goes to 10, and so on. Now, if you just draw these numbers somewhere in the plane, and you then draw a directed graph. So from each element, you draw an arrow to its image. So since 1 goes to 5, I have an arrow from 1 to 5. Since 5 goes to 9, I have an arrow from 5 to 9, and so on. 2 goes to 2, I just have a little loop from 2 to itself. Then you'll see that this directed graph that we have here is a disjoint union of cycles. So we have here 2 is a 1 cycle all by itself. This 1, 5, 9, 1, 5, 9, this is a 3 cycle. And I think there's a 4 cycle, there are no 4 cycles. There are 2, 3 cycles in here. I think 1, 5, 9 and the other one, can you spot it? It's here. It's 4. 10, 8, 4, 10, 8. So in this permutation, there are 2 1 cycles, there are 2 3 cycles, there are 2 2 cycles, and no 4 cycles or 5 cycles. Okay. Now, obviously, you know, 1 times 2 plus 2 times 2 plus 3 times 2 will add up to the size of the permutation, in this case, 12. So this is the basic structure of a permutation. And most of you probably know that the conjugacy classes in this symmetric group are determined by the cycle decomposition. So two elements are conjugate if they have the same cycle decomposition. So using this, we can find, there is a nice way of writing down class functions using polynomials. So let U be the ring of all polynomials in infinitely many variables, which I will call x1, x2, x3, and so on. And these variables will have the names that are hinted at in this previous slide. So given such a polynomial, you can construct, you can write down a class function on a symmetric group for any n. Namely, it's the function which takes a permutation w to q evaluated at the quantities x1w, x2w, x3w, and so on, where xiw is the number of I cycles in the permutation w. So from a polynomial, you get a class function on a symmetric group for every n. And we will write, so this q is a polynomial, but we can now think of it also as a function on a symmetric group, and we'll write for that value q of w. Okay, so if there are any questions at any point, or if I'm not saying something clearly, please feel free to stop me or type into the chat. Since I'm not always looking at the chat, maybe Anupam or Manoj can alert me if there's something on the chat. So I hope it's clear now what we are doing. We are taking polynomials and we are constructing class functions on all symmetric groups. So this is obviously going to be very useful for studying characters of representations. So we'll be interested now in families of representations. So for example, there's a very natural representation of the symmetric group. Sn acts on n-dimensional vector space just by permuting the coordinate vector. And now if you try to write down, so this is not one representation, but this is a family of representations. Cn is a representation of Sn. So we have one representation of each symmetric group. Right? So we have such a family. And if you ask what is the trace of, what is the character of this representation? Otherwise, you're asking what is the trace of a permutation on Cn? So then it's just the number of fixed points of W, right? So the permutation, how many fixed points it has? Because if you write down the matrix of W with respect to the standard basis of Cn, then the fixed points will only contribute to the trace, and the trace will be the number of fixed points. So the trace of this family of representations is given by X1. So it's just X1W. So for every Sn, there's just this one polynomial X1, which gives the character of this representation. And this representation is not irreducible in the sense that you can break it up into smaller representations. So in this case, you can see that the all ones vector spans a subspace of Cn that is invariant under the action of Sn. And its orthogonal complement, which consists of vectors whose coordinates sum up to zero, they form another invariant subspace. And that's the decomposition I have shown here. So we have Cn is this span of the all ones vector, which and another representation, which is the sum zero vectors. And this is again a representation of Sn, this Vn minus 1, 1. And this is what is an example of an irreducible, both these are in fact irreducible representations of Sn. And the character of this representation is given by X1 minus 1, just because this is a one-dimensional representation whose character is constant, always 1, is the constant function 1. So this represent this family of representations. So this is not just one representation. This is a family of representations, one for each Sn. Its character is given by X1 minus 1 for all n greater than or equal to. Okay. So so there are a lot of representations which have this nice property. Let's look at another one. So this is the kind of representation which motivated me to learn these methods which I'm describing here. So let's look at things, representations of Sn that come from tensor operations on Cn. So for example, you have these symmetric tensors on Cn. So here we have sim2Cn, which is, one way of describing it is it's the you take Cn tensor Cn and you just look at tensors that are invariant under flipping the two tensor factors. So so you have this flip of the two tensor factors, that's an involution on Cn tensor Cn. Its fixed points are sim to Cn. So you must have seen while studying tensor calculus that this sim 2 Cn will have, so if Cn has bases E1, E2, En, then the sim 2 Cn will have basis vectors like E1 squared, E1, E2, E1, E3, more generally Ei, Ej, where I is less than or equal to J. So these are the kind of vectors that will span it. Another way of thinking about it is that a basis of sim to Cn is given by multi-sets of size 2 drawn from n. So this E1 squared corresponds to the multi-set which has 1 two times. So that's a multi-set. This one corresponds to the multi-set 1, 2. 1 occurs once and 2 occurs once and so on. So the basis of sim to Cn is multi-sets of size 2 drawn from n. And what is happening is that these permutations in W, they are just acting on, you know, each of these components, E1, E2, by permuting them. So EI will go to EWI. And so, in effect, when you look at the sim2Cn, its trace will be the number of multi-cells that are fixed by W. Just as earlier we had the number of elements of the set 1 to n that were fixed by W, now we have the number of multi-sets of size 2 whose elements are drawn from n that are fixed by W. So let's just look at what kinds of multi-sets can be fixed by W. So we have this W. It may be something like this. In this picture, it has some 1 cycle, some 2 cycles, some 3 cycles. Let's see what kinds of multi-sets of size 2 can be fixed by this. So for example, if I just have a multi-set 2 to the power 2, right? That will be fixed by this because the 2 goes to 2 in this. Okay, but I could also have something like this. 3, 7 is a 2 cycle. So if I take the set 3, 7, that is also fixed by W. And one more. I could also have, let's look at the example here. So I have 2 1 cycles here, 11 and 2. If I take this multiset 2, 11, 2 is also fixed by W, 11 is also fixed by W. So this multiset 2, 11 is also fixed by W. These are the three kinds of multisets with 2 elements that are fixed by W. So there are 3 kinds of them. Here I have described them. So they are either the multiset of the form I occurring 2 times, where I is a fixed point of W, namely a 1 cycle, or I, J, each occurring once, distinct elements, where I and J are fixed points of W, or I, J, where IJ is a 2 cycle of W. So these are the 3 possibilities. And so using that, you can compute the trace. You just add up all these numbers. So this gives X1W, the number of 1 cycles. That's the number of multisets you get from 1 cycles. Here, of this kind, here we are looking at 2 1 cycles. So you get X1W choose 2. And then here you're looking at a 2 cycle. So just take X2W. So the character polynomial, so to speak, of this representation SIM2CN is X1 plus X1 choose 2 plus X2. And if you expand it out, you'll get X1 squared plus X1 by 2 plus X2. So this simple expression captures the characters of all these, this infinite family of representations SIM2CN for all n. So now we can make a general lesson. A family Vn, so here Vn is a representation of Sn, is said to have eventually polynomial character if there exists a single polynomial Q in these variables x1, x2, x3, and so on, and a positive integer capital N, such that for all small n greater than capital N and for all W in S subscript small n in that symmetric group, the character of the representation Vn is given by this polynomial. So here we are, this word eventually means that we're allowing for a finite number of n to be skipped. But we can also drop the adjective eventually and just say polynomial character, in which case we will just take n equals 0, I guess, for all natural numbers it should work. So for example, here, this is a polynomial character, and this guy is an eventually polynomial character because it works for n greater than or equal to. In some sense, maybe the representation doesn't even make sense for n equals 1. So you may also have a partially specified family. Let me not get into that kind of. So why are these interesting? Representations in such families have some stability properties which occur quite frequently. So what is the stability property? So we have 2 eventually polynomial characters, families of representations with eventually polynomial characters, then the dimension of the SN homomorphisms between these 2 families is eventually constant. So somehow you could also say that the inner product of the characters of these two representations is eventually going to be constant. Okay, so any questions so far? Okay.
So Amritan, so you said dimension of Hermitian is eventually constant. What do you mean by that?
So this is a number, right? It's a non-negativity.
Yeah, number, yes.
So what I'm saying is that for n sufficiently large, this number will just stabilize. It will be fixed.
So that number depends on the n's above in your definition of eventually polynomial characters. So
it could be larger than this n. So yeah, it could be larger than this capital N. So if there exists some other integer n prime such that for all little n greater than n prime, this is yeah, that's a good question because it's not going to be the same n. Probably usually greater than n, such that. Dimension. Sn vn wn is equal to dimension Sn plus 1 vn plus 1 wn plus 1 for all n greater than. So all these values will be the same after some point. So in particular, if one of these families consists of irreducible representations, then we'll say that the multiplicity of that irreducible representation will become the same in Vn. So this kind of phenomenon occurs in a lot of representations that arise from topology. Whenever you have an SN action on a topological space, the representation also, the cohomology groups become representations of SN. And Church, Ellenberg, and Fab, they were looking at representations of this kind which come from configuration spaces. You look at the space of configurations of n points in a topological space and try to compute its cohomology. And they discovered these kinds of stability properties. And they were able to characterize them in terms of something called FI modules involving a lot of category theory. They proved that representations, families of representations which come from finitely generated FI modules have these kinds of stability properties. In fact, they have eventually polynomial character. It turns out that this is basically just a combinatorial way of dealing with such things. Okay. Anyway, I hope I answered your question.
Yes, thanks.
Yeah. Okay. Any more questions? Nothing on the chat. Okay, let me move on then. So now the next, so that was character polynomials. And now I want to talk about symmetric functions, which also play a large role in studying the characters of the symmetric. So firstly, we'll start with symmetric polynomials in n variables. So you can all imagine what they are. You just take polynomials in n variables, and then you choose those polynomials which don't change when you permute the variables. So that's what I have denoted here by lambda subscript n, is the Sn invariants in the ring of polynomials in n variables, and this itself is a subring. If you add or multiply to symmetric polynomials, you get a symmetric polynomial. So now what we want to do is we want to take somehow symmetric polynomials in infinitely many variables. And so what you do is, firstly, you note that if you take polynomials in n plus 1 variables, you can get a polynomial in n variables by setting the n plus first variable to be 0. So this gives rise to a ring homomorphism from the polynomial, symmetric polynomials in n plus 1 variables to symmetric polynomials in n variables. And we define this ring of symmetric functions to be the limit, the I guess this is the projective limit of these things here under these maps. So it ends up being sequences of polynomials. Fn is a polynomial in n variables, symmetric polynomial, such that when you substitute 0 for the last variable in the n plus first polynomial, you get the nth polynomial. And this ring is a graded ring. You can talk about degree d homogeneous symmetric polynomials and therefore also symmetric functions. If this definition is a bit abstract, there's an alternate viewpoint. We can think of them as formal sums. So they are typically, usually we think of a polynomial as a finite sum of monomials, but these are, we can think of, these things come as sums of infinite sums of monomials. So let's just firstly talk, set some notation for the monomials. So let's take alpha to be a sequence of non-negative integers, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and so on. And such that the total sum of these things is finite. So that means obviously that, you know, all but finitely many of these indices are zero. And I will denote by x to the power alpha, x1 to the alpha 1, x2 to the alpha 2, and so on. So that's a monomial in infinitely many variables. So it has only finitely many factors, and its degree is what I've called mod alpha. Now, given a permutation of the natural numbers, you can talk about W applied to alpha. And it's just this alpha of W inverse 1, alpha of W inverse 2, and so on. So this is a permutation. I believe this is a left action. This is a permutation of S infinity on these indices. And you can realize the ring of symmetric functions that I described earlier as formal sums, C alpha x to the power alpha, where C alpha is invariant, is constant on orbits of the S infinity action on these indices. So C alpha is CW alpha for every alpha and for every W in S infinity. The slightly unsettling thing here is that you have infinite sums. So you wonder that without some notions of convergence and so on, what operations can you do on these things? It's not a problem. Multiplication turns out to be well defined, because if you try to find the coefficient of any monomial in a product, only finitely many terms will contribute. And so this is a perfectly well-defined ring. So this is the ring of symmetric functions, two different ways of thinking about it. And this is a very important ring in algebraic combinatorics. So given a partition, you can talk about firstly a monomial symmetric function. So a partition, I mean just a sequence, maybe infinite, of non-negative integers, which are weakly decreasing, and again I impose this condition that their sum is finite, which forces that, you know, after some point these are zero. And I can talk about m lambda. It's a sum of x to the alpha, where alpha runs over all the indices that come from permuting this lambda in S using S infinity. So for example, if I take lambda equals 2 1, then I'll get all monomials of the form xi squared xj I not equal to j. Because I can take x1 squared x2, and then by permuting these things, I can get, I take any some permutation which takes 1 to I to 1 and j to 2, then I will get this from that permutation. So this is M21 is going to be sum over I not equal to j x1 xi squared xj. Sometimes you will have like, so if you take M11 for example, then you'll have xi xj, you don't want to repeat it again as xj xi. So you take all the distinct, so this is as a set. I take the orbit as a set. I do not repeat any of these monomials ever. So each monomial, so to speak, of shape lambda occurs once. So that's M lambda, and it's called a monomial symmetric function. Then there are elementary symmetric function. So En is all monomials where all monomials of degree n, where each variable can occur with a power at most one. So you can write it as xi1, xin, where i1 is strictly less than i2, is strictly less than so on, in. And then these are called elementary symmetric functions. And then there is hn, which is summation. Now you allow these all possible monomials of degree n. Just take the sum of all, every single possible monomial of degree n. So that's I1 less than or equal to I2 less than or equal to in, xi1 dot 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 xin. So this is En and this is Hn. And from this, we can construct E lambda, which is E lambda 1 into E lambda 2 into E lambda 3, where lambda is a partition like this, and H lambda. And it's called the fundamental theorem of symmetric functions, which says that basically E lambda is a basis of the symmetric functions. More specifically, if I take E lambda, where lambda runs over partitions of D, then it's a basis of the Dth homogeneous symmetric functions of degree D. And similarly with H lambda and M lambda. So these are the three common, perhaps oldest bases of symmetric functions. There's another one which is very important in computations, which is called the power sum symmetric function. So this is a very obvious way to construct a symmetric function. Just take each variable and raise it to the power k. And then you can construct p lambda as a product over I, p lambda I. So p lambda 1 into p lambda 2 and so on. So that's called the power sum symmetric function. And then there's another one called the Schur function. I'm giving a definition here which is due to Jacobi. But it's perhaps the most interesting of these families of functions. And these also form bases of symmetric functions. In this case, it should be noted this is a basis when you work over Q. The other cases, they all are bases over Z, if you just take coefficients in Z. So we have these five different standard bases of symmetric functions. And there's a lot of nice theory about, you know, how to go from one basis to another and so on. So that's the basic this thing to symmetric functions. There's a lot of structure there. And Frobenius came up with this device for studying the representation theory of symmetric group in terms of symmetric functions. So it's called the Frobenius characteristic. What it does is it turns representations of the symmetric group essentially into symmetric functions of degree D. So it turns representations into symmetric functions, and the algebraic structure of symmetric functions, the ring structure, for example, but there are other aspects to it, is a Hopf algebra structure. So all these things have representation theoretic meaning. And so formal computations with symmetric functions is much easier than manipulation of characters. So the theory of symmetric functions gives a very powerful set of tools to study representations of symmetric groups. So let me define formally what the Frobenius characteristic is. And it is defined as follows. So by RSD, I mean the space of all complex valued class functions on the symmetric group. So this such functions depend only on their value, depend only on the cycle decomposition of the permutation. And given such a class function, it will give you a symmetric function homogeneous of degree D. So symmetric group ST gives rise to representations of symmetric functions of degree D. And the Frobenius characteristic is defined as the following sum over the symmetric group. So it's actually an average over the symmetric group. You take the value at W, but then you also multiply by this symmetric function pi raised to xi w. This xi is going back to our first slide. It's the number of I cycles of w. Okay, so that's what it is. So this is the definition of the Frobenius characteristic. It's some large sum over all permutations But this is a bit unmanageable because it's a sum over n factorial different elements. However, it turns out that it's not so bad because these elements fall into conjugacy classes that are indexed by partitions. Now, you can ask, what is the size of a conjugacy class? And you all know it's the order of the group divided by the order of the centralizer of an element in that class. Now, if you take an element W of cycle type lambda, where I'm going to use a slightly different notation, I'm going to say lambda is of 1 to the m1, 2 to the m2, and so on. If lambda has m1 parts that are equal to 1, it has m2 parts that are equal to 2, and so on. So, for example, the partition 3, 1, 1 is 1 to the 2, 2 to the 0, 3 to the power 1, and then you can go on writing 4 to the power 0, 5 to the power 0, and so on. But usually you just stop after, you know, there are no more non-trivial terms. You could even skip this. But anyway, so that's called the exponential notation. And so if you have a partition lambda in this exponential notation, then just by trying to understand what conjugation does to a cycle decomposition, you can show that the centralizer of an element with cycle type lambda is given by this z lambda, which is product I greater than or equal to 1, I raised to mi times mi factorial. So this mi factorial comes by permuting the mi cycles, and this is by rotation inside each I cycle by multiples of whatever, you know, the mi possible rotations inside an I cycle, which will lead to commuting with the permutation. So then the number of elements with cycle type lambda is d factorial divided by z lambda. So then you can replace this sum 1 over d factorial, and this then you just take this, you'll get d factorial divided by this, then 1 over d factorial will cancel out, and you'll only be left with this thing here, 1 over z lambda. And so then you'll have f of w lambda, namely the value at any element with cycle type lambda, and this thing resolves itself into exactly what is called p lambda. So this is a more sort of amenable way of computing this for many nice functions f. You can think of this as a sum over elements of the symmetric group or as a sum over partitions. Okay. If you've seen Polya theory, this first sum should remind you of the Polya cycle index. Okay, so let's just look at a quick example. Look at what is the characteristic of the trivial representation of SD. So in this case, it's the constant functions of actually of SD. So you just, this f is always 1, and you take 1 over d factorial summation w in SD, and then you take this product of pi to the power xi w. And if you apply Polya theory, for example, but there are other ways to show it too, this is just the complete symmetric function. So Polya theory says that the coefficient of some monomial counts something, and you show that whatever it's counting is 1 in this case. Every monomial occurs exactly once. Okay, so if you just take the constant function, its Frobenius characteristic is the complete symmetric function of degree d. Now, in general, you can take a representation and you can define its Frobenius characteristic to be the Frobenius characteristic of its character. So it's a theorem that the Frobenius characteristic. So firstly, irreducible representations of SD are indexed by partitions of D. Given a partition lambda, the representation corresponding to lambda is usually denoted by V lambda. It's called the spect module corresponding to lambda. Its Frobenius characteristic turns out to be the Schur function corresponding to lambda. So this is a very beautiful way in which Schur functions again occur in the representation theory of the symmetric group. They describe irreducible objects. They also occur in the representation theory of the GLN, polynomial representation theory of GLN, or in the representation theory of the unitary group again, as giving rise to irreducible objects. So this you know, the work of Frobenius and Schur really brought out the importance of Schur functions, and that's why I guess they're named after Schur. So that's one nice thing of irreducibles correspond to Schur functions, and we know a lot about Schur functions in general. Here's another property where I was saying, you know, that the properties of representations can be turned into algebraic properties of symmetric functions. So here's another. What does multiplication of symmetric functions correspond to on the representation theory side? So if you have V1 a representation of SD1, V2 a representation of SD2, then you can think of V1 tensor V2 as a representation of SD1 cross SD2. And then SD1 cross SD2 sits inside SD1 plus D2. You take a set of size D1 plus D2 and divide it into two parts, size D1 and size D2. And SD1 acts on the first D1 element, SD2 acts on the last D2 element. And so you can think of this as a subgroup. And then you do what is called induction. So you induce this representation to SD1 plus D2. And if you take its Frobenius characteristic, it will be the product of the Frobenius characteristics of these two representations. So if you combine this theorem with this example here, what you get is, for example, if you take SD1 cross SD2 to SD1 plus D2 of B1, just a representation of SD1, and on this side you take the trivial representation, then you'll just get the Frobenius characteristic of V1 multiplied by the complete symmetric function HD2. So any questions so far? So for example, we know a lot about Schur functions. So here's a property of Schur functions, which is called the Pieri rule. So to state this, maybe it's convenient to talk about Young diagrams. Given a partition, its Young diagrams is an array of dots I comma j. You have lambda 1 dots in the first row, lambda 2 dots in the second row, lambda 3 dots in the third row, like I've drawn in this picture. So for 3, 1, 1, this is the Young diagram. But we also draw boxes instead of dots because sometimes we like to fill numbers inside these boxes. So we usually just draw them as boxes. So we say that lambda contains mu if the Young diagram of lambda contains the Young diagram of mu. Practically, it means that part for part, the parts of mu are less than or equal to the parts of lambda. And Pieri rule, okay, so we need one more definition. We say that lambda minus mu is a horizontal strip if lambda contains mu and each column of lambda contains at most one box that is not contained in mu. So here's an example. The big partition consisting of green and orange boxes is lambda, and the partition consisting only of green boxes is mu. And in this example, lambda minus mu is a horizontal strip. There's not more than one orange box in each column. And similarly, there's something called a vertical strip, where you say that there's no more than one box in each row. So here's an example of lambda minus mu being a vertical strip. And Pieri's rule is a rule about multiplication of Schur functions. Firstly, let me just mention that HK is a Schur function corresponding to the partition with just one part, which is K. And EK is a Schur function corresponding to 1, 1, 1 repeated K times. And so this is somehow a rule for multiplying a Schur function by one of these very simple Schur functions. And it says that S lambda HK is the sum over all mu minus mu, such that mu minus lambda is a horizontal strip of size K, S mu. And if you multiply by EK, you get vertical strip of size K. So these are called the Pieri rules. And now let's go on and combine these two ideas of character polynomials and Frobenius characteristics. So if you have a family of representations as earlier, then you can talk about its total Frobenius characteristic. So I will just take a formal sum of all the Frobenius characteristics of all the representations. D goes from 0 to infinity. Okay, so this is not a symmetric function per se, because in a symmetric function you are only allowed, like a polynomial can only have a finitely many non-zero homogeneous parts. A symmetric function also has that property. Here you are allowed to have non-zero parts in all the degrees, and so it's in a slightly bigger ring, a completion of symmetric functions, where you allow non-zero parts in all the degrees. But this ring still turns out to be an algebra. When you try to multiply things, each degree, there are only finitely many other degrees involved. So this is, it's a bit like going from polynomials to power C. And so for example, if I take the trivial representation of SD for each D, then its total characteristic, we saw that this guy has characteristic HD, so its total characteristic would be H0 plus H1 plus H2 plus so on. So remembering that HN is, so just remembering that HD is summation I1 less than or equal to ID X I1 XID. You can show this identity that the sum of all these complete symmetric functions is given by this infinite product, which is very reminiscent of the Euler product for integer partitions. You just take this I as a subscript and make it a superscript. So that's the Frobenius characteristic of the most simple kind of family of representations, namely you take the trivial representation for each n. So you have any, in general, if you have any polynomial, you can talk about its total characteristic. Just take the Frobenius characteristic of it evaluated at the symmetric group SD and take the sum over all non-negative D. So you can talk about the Frobenius characteristic of a character polynomial. So now we are going from polynomials to this ring lambda hat. So we are going from Q to lambda hat. And this is what I call the total characteristic. Okay, hope most people are still with me. Any questions? Okay, so this it turns out it's that the Frobenius character, the total characteristic. So let's define these some special family of polynomials. Given a partition alpha, which is written in exponential form, that means that a1 parts equal to 1, a2 parts equal to 2, and so on. So this is a partition of a1 plus 2a2 plus 3a3, and so on. So let's say that's n. Then you can talk about, we'll define x choose alpha to be xi choose alpha I. So x choose k, where x is a variable, still makes sense. This is defined as x into x minus 1 into, not enough space here. It's just a polynomial, right? So x choose k equals x into x minus 1. You take k terms, x minus k plus 1. Divided by k factorial. And so you just take those polynomials in xi and then you multiply them together. So xi choose ai, product over all I. And this is an element of Q. And the theorem is that the Frobenius characteristic of this has a very nice form. It is h times p alpha by z alpha, where h is this h0 plus h1 as well. So this total characteristic actually lies in lambda hat. So this is, here's a fundamental identity from the theory of symmetric functions. H itself, when you try to express it in terms of power sum symmetric functions, it's just a sum of P lambda over Z lambda. So this is coming from Puglia theory, right? So that's that's, you know, the calculation we had done earlier of the Frobenius characteristic of the constant function. So anyway, so here's the thing. So the proof is not very difficult or anything. I've written it down here. You'll find a statement like this in, for example, McDonald's book on symmetric functions. Maybe I'll not go into the details of the proof since it's a bit, it's not difficult, but maybe it's a bit, you have to do it yourself. But the basic idea is to just, you know, use the definition of this Frobenius characteristic, and then there's some interchanging sums and products and things like that. And we use this fundamental identity in the end. So I'll skip the proof of this, but this is a fairly straightforward calculation once you are a little bit familiar with this way of writing partitions in exponential notation, power sum symmetric functions, and so on. So what's the point now? So if I have a general polynomial, I can expand it. So if I have,
Abhi, I have a question here.
Yes.
So you state what is Pierre rule.
Yeah.
Then, for what reason you have described that rule? Are you going to panic with something else?
I'll explain later. Not yet.
Okay.
So it's because we are getting this H times thing, so we'll get Pierre rule. Okay, so anyway, so I'll explain that a little later. So here's the thing. So if you have any polynomial Q in Q, then you can expand it in terms of, so normally we write it in this basis, x to the alpha, but maybe I should say capital X. But you can also write it in the basis C prime alpha, X choose alpha. This is another basis. Remember, X choose alpha is product over I, X I, A I. So this also forms a basis for this Q, okay? Because the leading term of this is basically X to the alpha. This is X to the alpha plus lower terms. So you can use some sort of triangular matrix argument to show that this is again a basis. And so if you want the Frobenius characteristic of Q, it is just going to be summation over alpha C alpha prime P alpha by Zeta. So using this rule, you can compute the Frobenius characteristic of any polynomial. And so for that, it's useful to have an expansion of the polynomial in terms of this basis, which I call X choose alpha basis, which I call the binomial basis. So if you have a polynomial and you want to express it in terms of binomial basis, there are classical techniques available, namely the difference operators. So you just define the difference operator in the ith variable, delta I, f. You just take the variable incremented by one and subtract the function itself. So that's the difference operator. And then given a partition alpha, you can define the difference operator delta to the alpha by delta 1 to the applied A1 times, delta 2 applied A2 times, and so on. And then you can just show that F is given, the expansion can be given just in terms of these difference operators. And so if you want to compute the Frobenius characteristic, then what's happening? Yeah. So I'll give you a way to. So if you want to compute the Frobenius characteristic, then you just take characteristic of F will be sum over alpha delta alpha F 0. P alpha by Z alpha times capital H. That's the, I think I forgot to put the capital H here. So So that's the Frobenius characteristic. So given any function f, we have a nice algorithm to compute. Given any polynomial f, we have a nice algorithm. This is an honest to goodness polynomial in the variable x1, x2, x3. It's a finite expression. We have a simple algorithm to compute the Frobenius characteristic, which can be implemented in your favorite computer algebra system. So you can also go the other way. Suppose you know the total characteristic. Can you find the character polynomial? And for that, you need to take this h and invert it. So this h is h0 plus h1 plus h2. So it's product of 1 over 1 minus xi. So h inverse is product of 1 minus xi. Flip this thing. And that turns out to be e0 minus e1 plus e2, which I call e. So h times e is 1 in this completed ring lambda hat. So here's the point. So we know that the Frobenius characteristic of x choose beta is p beta by z beta times h, which means that the Frobenius characteristic of any polynomial is h times some element, some honest to goodness symmetric function that is not in the completion, but some thing with finitely many degrees. So just because this p beta by z beta forms a basis of lambda, and x choose beta forms a basis of capital P. So the theorem that we get from this simple observation is that a family has polynomial character. That is, you can express the character of a family as in terms of a character polynomial if and only if its Frobenius characteristic is capital H times something in a symmetric function. Okay, so this is contained inside lambda hat a priori, and we want it to be H times lambda. So this is a proper subset of lambda hat, and it has eventually polynomial character if it is H lambda plus some finite perturbation. So here's an algorithm to determine the character polynomial of f given its total characteristic. So you're given f, this is in lambda hat. So I want to find out whether it comes from a polynomial family or and also to compute it. So you start with f. You invert the h. So we know that this is going to be h times something. So you invert that. So you compute g equals f times e. If g is a symmetric function, then you expand g in the power sum basis. And then you output, you replace this p alpha by z alpha by x choose alpha. If it is not, then you know that f does not have polynomial character. So that's a very concrete and effective algorithm for that. And I'll just end with an example of some family of representations which where you can apply this kind of computation. So we looked at sim2cn, but we can look at sim_dcn. And now this is not just one representation. We can vary n, and this gives us a representation of Sn. And one can show that it's Frobenius characteristic is given by this product of, so let's define ht to be, so this is an element of lambda, and then you take power series with coefficients in lambda in the variable t. So this is now, I'm also letting d vary, the sim d, the degree here. And so I'm not just looking at one family of representations. I'm looking at a family of families of representations, and there's a I won't go into the proof of this now, but there's a proof using for example combinatorial species, which will give you that the Frobenius characteristic of this this generating function sort of is given by this very simple expression. This is just h of 1 times h of t times h of t squared and so on. So in this, you must isolate the coefficient of t to the d, and you will get the total characteristic of the family V and D. So if you do that, what you'll get is V and D is H, this is H of 1, right? You just put T equals 1, you get H. H times sum over all partitions of D, product over I, HI. That just picks up the coefficient of T to the power D over here. And we know from our theory of power sum symmetric functions, so on, that HAI is a sum of, you take all partitions of AI, sum over all partitions of AI, and you take the corresponding power sum symmetric functions divided by that Z, the centralizer of a permutation with cycle type beta. So the conclusion from this that you can draw is, that so if I take this equation and then I take the expansion in terms of power sum symmetric functions, so what I'll get is right, so let's take this and let's put it down here. So then now what I have to do is I will write this in terms of the power sum symmetric function, so this will become H times and then I'll get sum over beta I partition of AI and then I'll get P beta I by Z beta I. Right? That's what this gives here. And then what I need to do is I need to replace this by X choose beta I. And so I get this very nice formula for the character polynomial of this family SIMD CN. So that's just one application of this. I guess I did answer Digjoy's question, but it's time to stop. So.
Thank you very much, Professor. It's time for discussion now. Please put forward if you have any questions, comments, or suggestions.
Hello. I have a question. Oh, maybe it is trivial and clear from the definition. Are irreducible representations of SN polynomial? Do they correspond to polynomial characters or eventually polynomial characters?
Yeah, so that's a great question actually. So there is a way to do that. So an irreducible representation is just one representation for one SN. So you need to create families of representations. So what you do is you do the following thing. So if you have a partition lambda, you take the family V. So for a representation of n, for n sufficiently large, you take n minus size of lambda. So suppose lambda is lambda 1, lambda 2, and so on. Then lambda 1, lambda 2. So if n minus lambda, size of lambda is greater than, you need here n is greater than or equal to lambda 1 plus size of lambda, then this is a partition of n. Okay, so let's call this partition lambda box n. It's called the padded partition. So this has polynomial character. And there's a formula for it. I don't know if I remember it. Yeah, anyway, let me not try to write it down. It's a formula you can find in McDonald's book.
Okay, so we saw that symmetric powers are eventually polynomial characters. Yeah. And so, exterior powers are irreducible representations parameterized by Hooke.
So the thing is, Yeah, so that's very good. Again, I think I interrupted your question, but I know what you're going to ask. So every representation of
GLN. I think you understood my question.
Yeah. So every representation of GLN corresponds to some, you know, it's a virtual sum of symmetric tensors. Even the exterior powers can be written as a virtual sum of symmetric powers. Virtual sum of a tensor product of symmetric powers, sort of given by, you know, so you can write, so if W lambda is the irreducible representation corresponding to lambda, then you can write it as determinant of sim, it's something like Pierre's rule, lambda I plus J minus I, or I minus, yeah. Where here, multiplication should be interpreted as tensor product. Okay, in the, maybe in the representation ring. So every representation of GLN is actually, so this again, you know, you can think of it as a parameter. So everything is built out of these symmetric things. And so it follows that every one of these representations also has polynomial character, and we compute this technique that I have described here. Once you know the character of this thing, you can compute for any representation.